I'm the director of Emmy Noether Research Institute, which was established in the early 90s as a joint venture of the German government through the Minerva Foundation and Bar-Ilan University. Mathematics is everywhere. It relates to societal challenges, it relates to biological phenomena, it relates to every aspect of our life. We used to say that mathematics is the queen of science. I say, indeed, mathematics is the queen of science, but it's also the servant of science. And moving from being a queen to being a servant is a two-way traffic.
Our group deals with complex systems. And to understand what complex systems are, I believe that an example can be worth a thousand words. So we all agree that your brain, for instance, is a complex system, right? Now, what makes it a complex system, though? Well, I would argue that it's because there is a very big divide between the building blocks and the behavior of the entire system. The building blocks of the brain are neurons. But somehow, you bunch together 100 billion neurons, you get a completely different phenomena because neurons don't know how to think, don't know how to feel, don't know how to apply motor skills. But somehow, together, they seem to cooperate and create this emergent phenomena. So when we see this distinction between the macro scale behavior of a system and its building blocks, or where simple building blocks can provide very complex behavior, we call this a complex system. The potential applications are broad. So one of them that I mentioned was the spread of epidemics in the social system. But the idea is that when an epidemic spreads, it's really information. Now, if we are able to predict the patterns of spread of information, then imagine the following idea, that once a local failure has was instigated in the network, and now it begins to propagate, we have a projection. Just like we can predict the spread of a disease, we'll predict when the failure will reach different power systems. And then we will shut down power systems at strategically timed intervals to stop this spread. This today sounds a little bit like science fiction, but I think we're heading that way. And I think that if we are able to predict the behavior of complex systems, then the next natural step is how to influence their behavior in a desired direction.
Sometimes we don't even realize that there is mathematics behind what we are doing. But when you go into a hotel and you put your plastic card into the door, in fact, you are using a mathematical theorem that was proven 300 years ago by Fermat. So it is everywhere. When you listen to a music, to a record of a CD, then it would sound very bad if there wouldn't be mathematics that would be correcting the recording.
We have at Bar-Ilan a very unique and enlarged program for young students. And we have close to 100 students every year that start with mathematics. And we don't actually want all of them to do only mathematics because they need to develop their own skills and be exposed to other options. So some of them take physics or engineering or computer science, but they all start in mathematics, and many of the best of them actually continue in mathematics.
Okay, so my specialism in cryptography is related to what is called cryptanalysis, which is the assessment of the practical security of cryptographic schemes. So if we want say speak to each other so that other people will not listen to our conversation, we need encryption. So this encryption is based on some mathematical principles. It appears that in order to have the encryption efficient and secure, the best way we know currently is to use some mathematics and sometimes very sophisticated mathematics like elliptic curves and things like that. And so when we analyze the security of those systems, this is really work for a mathematician.
I think that we as mathematicians should be more outreaching. So we should spend more time, more thought on exposing what we are doing to the general public because we owe them. I mean, they support science, they support mathematics, they should see the fruits.
Indeed, there are less women in mathematics. And you might think that this is because they are not as good in mathematics as men. I say very firmly that they are as good in mathematics as men, and in some fields they are even better. You might say that it's not because they are discriminated, just because maybe they don't like the profession or they are not good enough. So I say very firmly they are as good as men, and probably in some fields they are even better. My role model is Friedrich Hirzebruch. I knew him personally. He is a great mathematician from Germany. The culture of doing mathematics have evolved in the last 20 years dramatically from being a profession that you would sit with yourself and a paper and a pen and some books, and you try to extend and understand and build different models for mathematics, to become a collaborative profession. And the Emmy Noether Institute is dedicated to foster collaboration between mathematicians that living all over the world. I see the future of the Institute going together with the future of mathematics. Mathematics have started 4,000 years ago. It's the oldest profession. It's the only discipline that doesn't change. What was true 3,000 years ago is still true today. It's not like in physics or in biology that the models are changing. And the Institute is part of this phenomena that mathematics is everywhere and mathematics is forever. Now we have new challenges for mathematics. And I'm personally involved and the Institute involved in mathematics in cybersecurity, mathematics in cryptography, mathematics in the Bitcoin, mathematics in the blockchain, mathematics in complex systems, all these new sociological and technological challenges that we are facing nowadays in order to have stable society. So I see the Institute research and work for the benefit of society.